This is TJ Rivera, minor league coach with the Cleveland Guardians, and you're watching the Legends on Deck podcast with host Brian Koss and David Conde.
Welcome to episode 65 of the Legends on Deck podcast. I'm Brian Koss, along with my co-host, David Conde.
What's up, Brian? Hey,
how you doing today?
It's hot outside.
It's not cold
anymore.
Really? It's the cooler up here. It's only 75 today. But
it's not raining, and it's not horrible snow weather, so we're good.
Yeah. All right. Well, yeah, we're getting into it now. We're heading into hot season soon enough. Today we're going to welcome Connor Cornell as our guest on the show today. Connor's a Minnesota native who played college baseball at St. Mary's University in Minnesota. He played independent ball up in Minnesota after that. And in recent years, Connor's been focused on building an instructional baseball program down in Southwest Florida, where he and is a co-owner of MacStrength Florida, an instructional facility for both baseball and softball players. Connor, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, guys. I'm excited to be here.
No, thanks for being here. Before we get to the exciting things of what you're doing down here in Florida, let's go back a little bit. Let's go back in time. Kind of like, you know, we like to get a background of all our guests, kind of see where you started in the game, you know, what age you started, who introduced you to the game, when did you realize that you wanted to continue playing this game at another level, you know, how was high school? So kind of like give us a little bit of a summary up to when it first started.
Yeah, it's kind of funny because I don't have a distinct moment where it was like, this is where it started. It really kind of, I was just kind of born in it, and I just, it was almost part of me is how I kind of see it. I mean, from the second I could grip anything or walk around, I was basically fed a baseball bat and the baseball. So it all just kind of worked out, and I just never put it down. So my family, my uncles and cousins, a lot of college baseball players around there. So it was kind of just the environment I was in. And I really had a knack for the game. It was just what I wanted to do. A lot of kids like to go to the park and play tag. And I just wanted to throw a baseball up and play wiffle ball and do all those things. So growing up, like you said, I played up in Minnesota, and it was a suburb of Minneapolis, St. Louis Park, about 5 minutes outside. That's where I played Little League, went through and did all the travel programs and did that whole thing all the way up until I got there for high school. In high school, I played 4 years there. Was a captain my senior year. We had a couple good years. My junior year, we were a part of the team that was the first one to go back to the section final. So around here it's districts, up north it's sections for like the playoffs at the end of the season. And that program hadn't been there since the 1970s, 60s, I believe. Don't quote me on it. It'd been over 50 years. And so we were the first ones to go back there and do that. And we were kind of like a 500 team all season. And then we just got hot at the right time. And it was really fun team to be a part of. And we were, what's cool now to see is that we kind of set the expectation for that town that that's what we're going to do moving forward there. And what's cool to see now that I'm 7-8 years out of it, They've consistently been in that game. Before I moved down here, I was an assistant with that team for a little bit of coaching, and they were the first team to actually win that game and go to the state tournament since, you know, 1950s. So it's been really fun to kind of see how that program has taken that success that we were able to build on and just keep going with it and keep setting new expectations, because now it's not just to get to that game, it's to get to that game, win it, and go on to the next thing. And so it's fun to see what they'll do next and what bar they're going to set. But long story short, the game has just been something that I've always wanted to do, wanted to be around. And it's something I still can't put down.
So let's look back for a second. So I'm from New York originally. And when we played baseball, I mean, if you play four ball, you were freezing. And then I think we didn't start to like maybe April. And I think we played a lot of summer ball there too, because, you know, it's cold. And then, you know, and then you think about Florida, the only summer ball that happens down here is the travel ball, because, you know, but you can play year round four ball. So how was it in Minnesota? I mean, Minnesota is colder than New York and there's snow all the time. So
yeah.
What time of the year were you playing, and how did that feel?
Yeah. So me personally, I played year round. And it just looks different than it does down here. So spring baseball is very tough up there. I'm sure it's somewhat similar to what it was in New York. You'll have a freak snowstorm in April and you'll be set back for 2 weeks from playing. And you basically just have to practice inside in the gym until you can get back outside. And a lot of those games in March, April, it's 30, 40 degrees, flurries. It's tough baseball. You can't feel your hands. So it's definitely a time of year that you really got to be mentally tough and do a lot of prep work. A lot of funny stories too, because you get in there and there's heaters and you can't even feel your hands, burn your hands on it because you don't know what you're doing. Like, it's just, it's a tough place to play in the spring. Getting to the summer in Minnesota it's fairly humid. It's kind of similar to like this time of year, here in Florida, like this, what are we, March timeframe. It's pretty similar to what this is now. Very humid, a lot of summer ball going on there. And then fall, it kind of starts to feel like spring again, where it's cold, ground is hard, balls don't really fly when you hit it. A lot of pitching duels, then you got to deal with walks because pitchers can't feel their hands. But it's all good stuff, because then they get to learn how to play in that environment. Because if you want to play for a long time, that's, you're going to have to figure that out. Just like you have to figure out how to play in the heat down here. It's just differences. There's different challenges that you find. So how it looks in the winter then when you're up there is, if you want to get games, and you basically have to travel. So you have to join a travel organization that's going to go down to Georgia, here in Florida, Vegas, California, do Arizona, do all those tournaments where you can go play different teams across the country. So I was lucky enough to be able to do that and kind of be able to play all year round, even though the weather doesn't really allow for it up there.
What position did you start off with, and which one did you end up at?
Yeah.
You felt like this was my position.
Yeah, it's a good question. And I've had multiple positions that I've felt like that. Growing up, I was always middle infielder. Once I got into high school, I was at second base through my junior year of high school. Senior year, I'm kind of leaving this part out. Somewhere along the lines in high school, I grew like 6 or 7 inches over a span of about 6 to 7 months. It was pretty crazy. I went from about 5'9" to 6'3" in a very short amount of time. So I then was kind of like this wonky, I was trying to figure out my body a little bit. So then I moved over to the corner. I went over to first base. That's where I played my senior year. Going into college then, I went out to the outfield, and I played out in the outfield for about 2 seasons, and I moved back to first base for my junior and senior year there. Yeah. So long story short, I played about everywhere besides catcher. So that's actually something that I've really appreciated about my experience, is that I was able to play so many different spots so that I have perspective to talk to these athletes about. because besides catcher, catcher's a spot that you got to get some guys.
That's a special position. Everybody can do that.
I'll tell you what, yeah, you got to be a different breed to be back there. But yeah, I'm able to speak on my experience playing all over the place. And it also it allowed me to get into the lineup more often, just because I was able to plug in different spots. And so that's something I really harp on our guys, is that you have so many guys. And I think it's something that's kind of become more of a thing recently, is that players, even when they're like 13, 14 years old, they say, I'm a second baseman.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay, you are maybe a second baseman for now, but it's going to be completely different, I guarantee you, when you're 17, 18 years old. And especially if you want to play college baseball on a team that's good, like, they're going to have multiple guys who were stud shortstops. And that's how it works. So what you get a lot of shortstops that come in college, and then they end up becoming outfielders, and then they become second baseman, and then they become first baseman, just because there's one position, there's one shortstop. And so if you're not that shortstop, you got to find another spot to go play. So that's just something that I really want to keep preaching to my guys, because I think that's very important, is that you don't get so hard-headed and stubborn on one spot. And so I was able to kind of embrace each position and get some valuable experience at each spot.
So I'll say one thing, and I'm probably preparing my kids for that level. If you come to one of my games, you'll see that the positions change every inning.
Right.
Kids at second base and the outfield. So I'm moving everybody around. I tell them the same thing. You need to have multiple positions that you can do. So when you go to high school, you can get on the field more often. It's not about being the starter baseman. It's about getting reps and being on the field as much as possible, so that people can actually get looks, if that's the case, you want to go play college baseball.
That's exactly it. That's spot on.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's been actually, I'm glad we actually got into that question, because we've had that conversation, I think, David, with a few different people recently. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's really about, if you want to play, you got to find a spot on the field. So you can really limit yourself. I think there's professional ball players that have limited themselves by saying, hey, I'm a middle infielder, right? And so if they could, they might find a spot on the team if they knew how to play other positions well, right? Or were willing to be flexible. I mean, look at Mookie Betts, just moved to second base. He was always an outfielder. So you got to be versatile. I mean, he's one of the best players in baseball, and he's willing to move positions.
Harper too.
So Harper, he's a first baseman now. So it's, I think it's really, it shows you, just with some of the best guys in the game, you've got to be able and versatile at different spots. So good.
100%. And that's something that even with the young guys, I'm coaching with a 13U team right now. And something that I tell them so much is, if those guys that are making hundreds of millions of dollars playing the game can move around, you can move around too.
So yeah.
It's just a mindset that I feel is really important to adopt if you want to play for a long time and play on good teams. You can go play in bad teams and decide you're going to play in this spot, but that's no fun. There's no fun in that. So
yeah.
If you want to play at a high level, be open to multiple spots.
Yeah, great point. Great point. So thinking about your high school experience and then going into you playing college baseball, what was that process like for you? So as a high school athlete looking at a place, you know, you probably knew early on, you know, that you wanted to go play at a college level.
Yep.
What was that process like? What are the schools that you were considering, and what made you decide on going to St. Mary's there in Minnesota?
Yep. So kind of circling back around to what I mentioned earlier, was that I was a late bloomer. I just randomly shot up at about 15, 16 years old. So 16 years old is when I first started to get some real interest from schools. And I really didn't know what I was doing. I didn't really know how to prepare for those meetings. And it's something that I'm excited to be able to help some guys prepare for, because it's an interview. Yeah. And if you don't prepare for it like an interview, you're going to get caught on your heels and you're going to lose their interest. So my goal was to find a spot that I felt wanted. Now, if that was right or wrong, I don't know. It worked out exactly how I wanted it to. But I wanted to go to a place where I really felt valued and like I wasn't just another recruit that came through a class. St. Mary's, they really stuck out to me, and it sounds kind of silly, but what they were sending me was handwritten letters. And just the thought behind handwriting instead of typing or texting, it meant something to me. And it's actually something that I have adopted in my life today, is that I like to send thank yous or even just like letters or anything. I always try and handwrite it, just because that little extra effort, I think, whether you realize it or not, goes longer way than a text. So I didn't choose that place because of handwritten letters or anything. It was a growing program. I loved Coach Winicky. He's still there. He's been there for over 10 years now. He's got a very cool story. He's started coaching that program at 24 years old, I believe. He was a year out of college when he started and took that program over. So he was actually coaching guys that he was teammates with, which I always found to be a very interesting dynamic that he figured out. So it was exciting. I always liked being the underdog. That was something I always liked. And St. Mary's is a small school up there. And the teams that they have to play are significantly bigger than them, like 5, 6, 7, 8 times bigger than them, depending on who we play. So it was always fun to be on that team that was significantly smaller. Maybe didn't have as much of the resources as other schools, but we would go up there and beat them. And it was always a really fun feeling for me. But I was kind of down to about 3 schools up there. There was St. John's, another school up in Minnesota. And then there was Northern State, which is out in South Dakota. Those were 3 that I really liked. But ultimately it came down to just the feel of the program, where it was going. I wanted to go into a place where I felt like I could plug into their style of play. And Coach Winicky, he's very good with, it's not loosey-goosey there. Like it's a pretty tight ship, which I wanted. I wanted the discipline, and I wanted to get some things out of it that I knew would transfer to the rest of my life, not just on the field, but learning how to work, learning how to work with teammates, having that brotherhood with your guys, because they become your best friends. So ultimately the whole picture had to come together. But style of play was a big thing for me, and just being in a place where I felt valued.
Now, did you guys come down to Florida here for your early season games?
Yeah. So they actually just, I think today was their last day of games down here. I think they're in Auburndale.
Yeah, for us, Matt?
Yeah, yep. So that's the preseason tournament they play, and then they go on a little road trip to Illinois, and then they usually start doing some non-conference stuff before they head into the conference season.
Right. Well, I mean, you mentioned, like, I mean, playing baseball in Minnesota right now is a little rough. Like you said, David from New York, I'm from Michigan. So we all kind of know what those early springs are like.
Yep.
But yeah, it's cool that these teams are able to come down and play, get their early season going, and then head back to campus.
Absolutely.
So what was that experience like? So you found the right fit, and then tell us a little bit about your years playing there at St. Mary's.
Yeah. I was there at a crazy time in the world. So first it started off, this is kind of going to give you a picture of kind of what shaped me and who I am. So I mentioned, I always kind of liked the underdog thing. At 19, I think I was 20 years old. It was 2019. It was going into my junior year of college. I had an open heart surgery. So I had to go through that whole thing where you're out for 3 months, completely out. Like, it's not like you get to hang out, do whatever. Like, you are sitting down, letting your chest repair. And it's a tough thing. So I was able to come back from that and play actually that fall season. So I got the surgery in May of 2019. And then by the time August came around, late August, when the fall season started, I was out playing again. And so that was a very big thing for me that I take a lot of pride in, that I was because that's a pretty big punch to the face is having that thing at that age. Like I was next to people that were 5 decades older than me going through the same thing. And I had to deal with that and get right back into it. So that was the first thing. And then COVID came around that following season that I had. So our season got cut short after we actually came down to Florida. We landed back in Minnesota a week later. We showed up to practice. They're like, there's this thing going on. Don't really know what's happening. We'll just keep you updated. And the next day we were packing our stuff up and leaving. So that was my junior season. And then my senior season was still weird we got to play a full season, but everything, like you're playing with a mask on and it's it shortened season a little bit. So it was definitely a wild ride, but I wouldn't change anything. It was definitely something that you were able to learn from each one of those kind of punches to the face as you go through that. But game wise, we had a lot of really good years. We were always in the playoffs all 4 years. Obviously besides the COVID year, my junior year, my senior year was a very exciting year. We were able, again, one of the kind of the trailblazers. So we were able to win the conference tournament and go on to the NCAA regional. And that was the first time that program had done that. Again, it was decades. I don't know the exact number, but it had been a long time. And that had been something that, that program hadn't done in a long time. So I was able to be a part of some very fun teams, a lot of guys that were really good people. And what's interesting is when you look back on it, you don't so much remember what games you went 4-for-4, what games you struck out, what games, whatever happened results wise. You more think about like who you were with and how they made you feel. And that's something that I really harp on with our guys here, is just that it's so easy to get caught up in the results part of the game and start to make baseball bigger than it is. At its core, and don't get me wrong, I'm all about playing baseball and playing it the right way and like going after it and winning. But at its core, it is a game. It is for enjoyment in your life. There's so much more to it, but that's what baseball is made to do. And so when guys are starting to get away from that a little bit, I feel like that's a good reminder, is that when it's all done and you're looking back on it, all you're going to do is you're going to remember all your times with these guys that you're playing with right now. And they're also going to remember who was good to you, you know? So long story short, I had a very good 4 years over at St. Mary's. It's an awesome program and I would do a lot for it.
Very cool. Very cool. I like it. So heading in, just after that, so we had a brief discussion about this before, but you had you played a little bit beyond college in a independent league, is my understanding, and did pretty well playing in that independent league. This is a Minnesota-based league, as you mentioned. Can you tell us a little bit about that and what kind of players get into this league? That, you know, rundown on that.
Yeah, so it's an independent summer league. It's not professional baseball. So essentially it's kind of an area, it's a Minnesota only league, but it's an area for guys that are in college to play for, like, in between their seasons, between their fall and their spring season. So they play there, and it's also just guys who are continuing to play. There's a lot of ex-college baseball players, ex-professional guys that come back and play in it. So it's competitive baseball. It's an awesome league. You play in all sorts of towns across the state. It's a big deal up there. And so I played 3 seasons there, and I had a blast with it. That kind of, that you mentioned, I had a pretty good year that final year. And it's kind of interesting looking back on it, because it was almost like I knew it was my last season, because I was going to move down here and be done with it and everything. And it was kind of that, just there's nothing to lose here. Like, this is it. Just go out and play. And that's really what I did. And so that experience, it really gave me perspective on mindset in the game. And if you can go about every pitch, every inning, every game with that mindset, I think you're going to have more success than you would if you were just so focused on like, who's watching me here, very results oriented mindsets that you can get into. So that's something that I've, again, from my experience and kind of seeing the differences there in my play based off of how this was working, that I'm able to talk with our guys on and really kind of shake them before they're in the position where it's their last season that I was in, when it finally kind of all really clicked in a big way for me.
And you actually, you said you stated you won the MVP and the batting champ that year.
Yep.
That's awesome accomplishment. So when even when you're talking to your kid to buy anything, I mean, you in a league, you rose above everybody else, and you know, you were standout. So, you know, when you're coaching kids, they always say, "Oh, well, what did you do?" And you're teaching me. Well, this is what I did. You know. But
going out on the top.
Huh?
I said going out on top, right?
That's right.
I want to go back for a second when you're talking about before about teaching, you know, playing the game that it's just a game, right? So you try to teach that with the kids, and I think, you know, you have a different level. You got travel, you got rec ball, whatever, but, you know, sometimes kids, you either have, they want to play because it's fun, they want to be around their friends, or they want to play because they're really serious about it. I think what you said was genuine, is that it is just a game. There are professional guys that get paid for it, but if we could look at it just a game and have fun with it, because what's the next thing that's going to happen? The one thing I learned about kids is that if you can make it that way, but also teach them things about life, then when they move on to the next phase in their life, they're not going to be playing professional. They're going to be doing something else. They take these memories they've had with their friends and their coaches and everything, and what was instilled in them. And the hope is that when they go on to their lives, they can instill the same thing to the next generation and keep doing the same thing because of what a game did for them.
Absolutely. And that's a really big thing for me is just, I have learned more on the baseball field than anywhere in my entire life, from any of the college classes, from anything about life, was on the baseball field. Learning how to discipline yourself, learning how to work for something, learning how to build habits. What even is a habit? Why do we practice? It's everything that you do on the field and are a part of a team. It directly translates into everywhere the rest of your life. Learning how to deal with people of different backgrounds, different viewpoints, facing tough stuff and rising above it and getting through it. Like, you're going to have horrible innings, and then you got to figure out a way to get out of it, stop the bleeding, and come back and hit the other team back in the face. And that's perfect for life, because you're going to get hit in the face a lot. You're going to have an open heart surgery when you're 20, but you got to rise above it somehow. I think that just the lessons that the game teaches you is so important. And as a coach, that is a big, big thing for me, is getting them to understand the big picture of the game. Like, it's not about just going out there and throwing strikes. It's about what going out there and having that experience is going to teach you and set you up for the rest of your life. And so that's just something that I'm going to continue to focus on, because it's very important.
And also team building, right? Like, in life, you know, we're in business. As an individual, you may do well in your business, but as a team together and build your team together and work with each other, that's what I tell the kids a lot. I get it, you want to hit home runs. I get it, you want to be the man in the field. But what are we going to do that is going to help the team win, rather than you do something that's going to help the team, that's going to make the team lose? So yes. How do we build that together? How do we work together to make that happen? And they don't realize it now, but they will, because, you know, we all play baseball sometime. You know, when I was younger, and you look back, you're like, wow, you know, the memories of being with a team, of winning something with a team and doing something together to build towards that, is so much more important than saying, hey, I went 5-for-5 that game, and I won. You know, not to say it's a great thing, but the team itself is just so much better when you can say, hey, you know, I have those memories with my friends.
Yep.
So we're going to shift gears a little bit to kind of what you're doing now. And I'm going to share, you know, we didn't share in the beginning, we sometimes do, but how I met you. So it was by chance. It was around the hurricane, right after the hurricane. And our church was asking for businesses to put their information on the church website so that maybe we can kind of help the community. And I kind of looked on there. I don't know if I was the only mortgage broker on there. So I kind of put my information on there, and I get a call, and Connor called me, but it was more for the real estate thing. He's a real estate agent at the time and kind of, you know, was kind of asking me about things. So we kind of connected that way. And then he shared his story with me. And then I had our league was having our first spring after the hurricane. And I put together a camp, and we had like Michael Tucker, Eric Rasmussen, Mel Collier. And I asked Connor to come down and be a part of it because I felt like his story was unique, you know, just because, you know, guys play professional baseball at one level playing, like I told Connor and I told the kids, playing college baseball is another great level to achieve. And if an independent baseball, and if you don't make it to the level after that, it's fine. It's where you were meant to achieve, but you achieved that. So he came down, he was a part of that. He did such an amazing job doing the infield with the kids, and everyone was like, you know, asking about him and stuff. So of course we stayed connected, and he told me, you share with me that you wanted to do this instructional thing and you were really, you know, gung ho about it. And I was upset that you were getting rid of the real estate part, but I understood. No, I'm just joking. But kind of bring us into the whole thing of how that started. Like what came to you and what made you decide, hey, this was something that really I wanted to do, and how did the whole MacStrength Florida get going, and you know, where is it at today?
Yeah, it kind of goes back to how it all started in the first place. Was I just couldn't put the baseball down. Like you get away from the game and I just, I have to be around it. That's what I've learned about myself. So I was really looking for ways just to get back into it and being on the field, because I was telling you that I was coaching up north with the high school that I played at. So I was still finding ways to be around it, and I didn't have that here yet. So I being connected with you was a huge blessing, and it's crazy how each little thing has kind of just gotten us to this point. But getting into it, I trained at MacStrength Minnesota in high school, and I'm very close with those guys. They did a lot for me as a player, and not only a player, as I was talking about, like just life things and learning how to really go about things in your life. So I had gotten connected with them, and they were looking to grow, and I was looking to get in the game. So it really just worked out for both sides to get this thing set up. Right now, we are all set up. We're ready to go. We're just getting some kind of final paperwork sort of things done with the government, which is never a super fast process, but we're getting close. We're very close to having doors open and having everybody come in there and start training. So it's a very exciting time for me. It's an exciting time for the business, and I think it's going to be an exciting time for the athletes down here in Southwest Florida.
Kind of go into us, into a little bit the philosophy behind what you guys want to achieve there. What's it all about? You know, what do you want? I mean, you shared a lot with teaching kids a certain way in the game, but what's the philosophy of your location?
Yeah, so we train to become complete baseball players. That's very important, and I think that's really hard to find right now. Is that there's, it's frustrating. I can see it now as a coach on that side of things. It's very frustrating as a coach to have a player who can only hit, but he can't play defense, or you have the player who can play very good defense, but he can't hit. And so we are trying to create the complete baseball player. That's where the holistic approach comes from, that you'll read in our website. Holistic, simplified, just means different parts connecting together. So for us, we train hitting, we train defense, we train becoming more athletic, so mobility and strength, to make players strong in every facet of the game and not be a one-dimensional player. I think that's very important. There's going to be options for people who don't want to do every single part, but that's there for them. It's kind of your one-stop shop. If you want to become a better athlete, a better player on the diamond, we're going to give you the resources that you need to be able to do that. Approach kind of what the philosophy is there. I wouldn't say there is one kind of specific philosophy. I think that's something that a lot of coaches kind of get themselves into trouble in, is that they're very stubborn on old school or new school. And we are kind of in between. Like, we're kind of everywhere. I think you have to be dynamic, because some players need to hear different things to get them to do things the right way. So for example, if a guy might need to hear kind of more old school terms to get his body to move the correct way, where the other guy, he may just be too steep at the ball. Just his bat is not on the plane for a long enough time to make contact. He has to be perfect with his timing. So he may need to hear more things about keeping staying on plane and kind of the new school sort of things that are kind of the buzzwords. So we're dynamic. We don't kind of subscribe to old school or new school. It really just depends on the player and how they move their body and what they respond best to.
I think that's an awesome point, because you got kids that, you know, I was watching a video, and I think it was someone from the Red Sox pitching, and a buddy of mine was at a game, and he kind of just filmed it. And the guy who's pitching, he just comes here and throws it, right? And what was the thing you always teach when you're younger? Bring the ball all the way back. You have to extend the arm. But if this guy is already at that level and he's doing it that way, so it's kind of like do you feel like it's kind of meeting the kids where they're at, working on the weakness but building up the strength to where, you know, where you're not totally just breaking them down and doing it only one way. It's kind of working with them where they're at, especially at an older age.
Absolutely. Yes, absolutely. It really depends on the player. You have to get a feel for them. They may do something that's kind of awkward looking, but you may be able to optimize around that thing and build off of what they already do well naturally. Like some guys, they may just naturally kind of close themselves off in their swing. And a lot of players, a lot of coaches, they would just take them and have them hit a certain way. If they're having success doing that, you can just build off of what they're already doing well and find different ways to incorporate different kind of teaching points through what they already do well. So really the big thing for us is that we're training players to become complete players, and our approach on that player depends on what they do well and what they respond to.
Awesome. And where's the main location where you guys are at now?
Yep, it's down in Naples, Florida.
That's a hotbed for baseball.
Yeah, we're very excited around there. I think we're going to be one of the few areas that you can really find what we're going to offer. And I think that's going to be exciting for our baseball and softball players down there to have that resource for them to come out to and really, if what they want to do is get better at baseball or softball, we're going to be the place to help them out.
And the one thing, it's great when you say the softball, because yes, we do have softball in Southwest Florida, but I've not heard of a place that actually gears towards, you know, I know of certain coaches locally that might do catching with the catchers and stuff with softball, but there's not really a location where the softball players can come through and really get the help. And being that I think FGCU has a softball team, I believe FSW might have one. This is just a great place that they can kind of like hone the skills to play locally in the college level.
Softball gets neglected, man. Softball's neglected down here. And so we're really excited to give them a place to go and get better, because there isn't much for them. Mm-hmm. And I don't know why that is. I just know a lot of former baseball players, typically they want to be around baseball, and I get it. But there's so many softball players that have a lot of talent around here. They just don't know where to go to kind of get some good instruction and a good place to train. So we're really excited to help those athletes out, because they've just kind of been shoved to the side for so long, especially around here, where we can really develop that. And I think it's going to be a very good thing for the entire sport in this area, just having a place for them to go get stronger, move faster, hit the ball harder. We're going to have somebody in there to help them with pitching, because I don't know anything about softball pitching. So we will give you the resource for that. But it's going to be an exciting thing for those athletes.
Well, you're finally giving them, and we'll get the word out to everybody that, hey, this is, if you're a softball player, this is where you need to go to get to that next level.
So I had a thought and it's kind of something that we've discussed with other people on our shows, but guys playing through the high school, the, you know, middle school, high school level, right? And then there's like, at some point there's a fall off, right? So people will, everybody stops playing at some point, but there's like only a small amount. It's like, I don't know what the statistics are off the top of my head, but it's like only a small fraction of players go on to play college, right? And of that, a very small fraction go on to get drafted or play professionally. Being around players, doing instructional, playing at the college level, seeing independent ball, all that. What do you think it is that really separates those guys that go on to play at the next level?
It's a really good question, and I absolutely love talking about this. In my opinion, it's mindset and work ethic. They're yeah. both very big buzzwords, and they're kind of cliche, so I apologize, but it's just the truth. Mindset, what I see in those players that kind of separates the good to great is an unwavering confidence that is not based on results, a confidence that's not based on results. So what that means is they don't feel good only when they're going 5 for 5. They feel good based off of the work that they put in. So their confidence is based on their preparation, everything that they've done before they step into the box. And so part of what that does too, is it keeps their mindset very steady, because if you're chasing results, it's a tool, but I think a lot of young players, especially, they obsess over batting average, and batting average just doesn't tell the full story of your plate appearances, right? So what we did in college, and one thing that I have been incorporating with my athletes is a quality at bats chart. And so a quality at bats chart is you basically get a batting average based off of your at bat. So like a 9-pitch at bat would count as a quality at bat. A hard hit line drive anywhere, even if it's caught, is a quality at bat. A walk is a quality at bat. A deep fly ball is a quality at bat. Sacrifice bunt, anything along those lines where you're productive, it goes towards your quality at bat average. And so when they're chasing that rather than results, because baseball is an extremely unfair sport, it is the only sport that you can go into your at bat and you can do everything right and hit a ball really hard, hit it flush contact, and it goes right at a guy and there's nothing you can do. You did everything that you could control and it just didn't work out. Whereas like basketball, you may have perfect release on your shot and it's going to go in and there's really no other factor unless like somebody were to block you, of course. But baseball is the one sport where you can be perfect and it's not going to go your way. Yeah. And so if your confidence and your mindset is all on these things that go up and down, you are going to be up and down as a hitter or a pitcher or just as a player as a whole. And so a lot of the players that you see that are inconsistent, like some days they're very good, some days you have no idea who showed up to the field. It's because they're putting their confidence and their mindset into things that waver rather than being at something that you can control and something that stays steady. Like think like Mike Trout. You ever see Mike Trout just like freak out and like throw stuff and do all that? He's a very steady dude. So he's one of the best baseball players in the game for the last however many years, right? So if you watch what those guys do, is that they're very even with their mindset. And so I think that's very important. Then the work ethic kind of speaks for itself. You're probably not doing what you really need to be doing if you want to be great, right? It's to build a habit, it's consistent daily work, right? And that's the whole point of practicing, is to build good habits. And you can't build good habits with one hour practice session extra a week. Like you're doing the bare minimum of extra work, basically. So those are the two things, mindset and work ethic, in my opinion.
Let me follow up on that for a second. So let's say you said you coached 13 U. So that's that age where it's kind of like they're changing, they have their own kind of mindset or what they, you know, what's kind of going on in their life. So I introduced to my kids stats last year only because I wanted to understand the game a little bit, you know, what kind of goes on in the game, what we kind of look at and stuff. And of course, you know, they start to now kind of compete with each other on this in an actual game. They're not competing. Who gets the best hits? Who's going to do this? Who's going to do that? At that age group, how do you kind of like bring it into them to understand your philosophy on what you just said? How do you How do you discuss that with them, and how do you get them to kind of hone it in rather than just kind of say, hey, I got five hits today and this is great? You know, what can I say to them to make to show them better?
It's really hard today because you have apps like Game Changer. I don't know if you guys are familiar with Game Changer. Everybody has access to their numbers with a couple clicks of their thumb, and it's right there. And stats are not a bad thing. Stats are just simply a tool. It's how you use it, which makes it good or bad.
Yeah.
And so that's why you hear a lot of kind of old school, very like hard on the old school thing, where they're like completely against numbers and stats. And I don't think that's not fair. I mean, there's some people who are just, they take the numbers too far and they obsess on it, and you almost forget how to compete because all you're focusing on is these numbers. When you kind of forget the whole goal, it's not to have this spin direction, this whatever. It's to go out there and get hits and score runs. But it's also it's how you use those numbers is where I'm getting at here.
Yeah.
So with our guys, what we do is we celebrate, as especially as coaches, we have the same reaction whether it's a hit or not based off of what they do on the plate. So that's how we reinforce it. It's almost like training a dog. I don't know if that's not the best comparison, but it's kind of what it is. It's what you reinforce. So if you as a coach are only giving them knucks and high fives and telling them good job when they get a hit, even if it's just a bleeder through wherever, but you're not giving them knucks, good job, whatever, when they hit a line drive that goes right at a guy, like that's where you're going wrong. Mm-hmm. And so we try and do the exact opposite of that. So those things that I talked about that are quality at bats, I like to talk on the hitting side of things. That's kind of where I focus more. And so like our guys at the plate, if they're up there and they're doing what we talked about, that would be a quality at bat. Like they have a 9-pitch at bat, but they strike out. They just ran that guy's pitch count way up. Right. So that's a good thing. Go give them knocks for that. So that's just the reinforcement piece.
No, that's perfect. I think you and I are in the same boat. So I'm going to come coach with you. Okay. Cause I think I'm doing exactly. I think this class right now, I'm like, yes, I'm doing exactly where I need to be.
Right on.
Yeah. I don't think I've heard the quality at bats thing. I mean, maybe I have, but I haven't heard it explained that way.
That was good.
I just think it's really, that strikes me as something that's really important. Mm-hmm. Because yeah, it is frustrating if you're a kid and you're in somebody's catching your long, you know, you, let's say you hit the ball hard, you know, you get 3 at-bats in a game or 4 at-bats in a game and you hit the ball hard and you know, the defense steps up and does it, or, you know, a sacrifice fly, which brings in a runner, is a quality at bat. Right. Yeah. So there's so many things that you can do to put either that you did the right thing, but there was nothing you can do about it, or you put runners in scoring position, you know, positive things that you did as a hitter that aren't going to get calculated in a batting average or in OPS or something like that. Right.
Yep.
So that makes total sense to me.
Yeah. It gives you the true picture as to how productive you are at the plate. And what's exciting about that you, especially your young guys, because it's not necessarily the most sexy thing, like a quality at bat average.
Right.
But if you explain to them that if you take care of this average, all of your other numbers will go up too.
Right. Yeah.
This average, you bring this up, I promise your batting average will be better. I promise your on base percentage will be better. I promise you'll have more RBIs. Right. It's how it works. So what we did in college that I really liked, and it's hard to do this with like a 13U team because you don't have like a locker room or a clubhouse where everybody can see. But what they would do is they would post a big thing up on the board and it would have everybody's quality at bat numbers right there in front of everybody. And you were basically competing to have the highest average on the quality at bats.
Yeah.
And so you could also see the guys that were on the bottom too, like, holy cow, I got to pick it up in the box a little bit. Like I got to find a way to add some value here. So it's a healthy competition, I believe. And if I haven't figured out how to really have that kind of like social pressure of having that posted up somewhere yet with the 13U guys, because we don't have that locker room. But once I figure that out, I'll let you know.
Is there a numbers thing that you add to points to different things that happen in a bat for you to get that average? Like the calculation, is it a special calculation that you guys would do?
No. It's pretty simple. So it's just if the chart goes across, I can send you a PDF actually so that you can see a visual one, but it goes across and each of the different at-bats that would be considered a quality at-bat is right across there. And if you have one of those, you give a check. And so then you just take your plate appearances by how many of those were quality, you divide those two, and then you get your average, and there's your average right there.
That's beautiful. I need to add that to my statistical stuff.
Yeah. and it's that is a healthy stat to obsess about. Batting average is not. Batting average is not, because again, it doesn't tell you the full story. You can be having very good plate appearances and go 0-for-8.
Yeah. It's, yeah, you can have that little dribble and that's an error, and the kid says, that's a hit. No, yeah. Oh, that was an error. Right. You're not getting that.
Right. Right. That's it.
That's cool. So we want to, are we ready to debut?
So yeah, I think so.
I'm going to let you, since you know what he's doing, I'm going to let you do his debut. You're going to announce it.
All right. We're going to bring my son, George.
Yep, right here.
Into the end of the show here for a minute. And George is going to, he's going to ask a question, our final question of the podcast for Connor. George is a young ball player himself, and he has a question that he would like to ask.
So what do you advise kids that want to go up to a new higher level?
Nice, George. Thanks for the question. I appreciate this one. This is very cliche again, but the work that you need to put in is more than you think. So that means daily, you need to be doing something to go towards your goals. So it first starts, what are you trying to do with the game? Are you trying to just go out there and have fun and hang out with your buddies? If that's the case, then just treat it like that and do not get upset with yourself if you're not hitting 400, right? Just understand what your goal is then. If your goal is to truly become great and play for a very long time, then you need to train like that. And so what that means, I kind of touched on this before, but a lot of people think they show up to a one-on-one session one time a week for 1 hour. And they're like, why am I not batting .300 now? And what I try to explain to them is that it's literally the bare minimum of doing extra work. Like that, you need to be doing 1 hour, whatever, every day to really separate yourself. Like, think like, this is extreme, but think like Kobe Bryant, if you listen to him talk about it, where it's like, if I train from 4 to 6, I give myself a break and I go from 8 to 10, I give myself a break and then I go 12 to 2 and I go from 6 to 8. I've had 4 different training sessions in one day. That's as many training sessions as some people have in a full week. And he did that in one day. And so that's where you start to see like the chart over time, where it's like, this guy's going right here. And then this guy starts to go right here. It just compounds over time. And so you need to decide what your goal is, and then you need to put the actions in the place that align with that goal. So, George, long story short, you need to work hard every single day. Does that make sense?
Yep, it does.
All right, good deal.
I've heard that before. It was like, wasn't there like a thing that was like, if you like practice like 20 minutes a day or something, you'll get like, become like the best player ever or whatever, something like that?
I believe you there. Yeah, you'll have to show me where that chart is. but yeah, it's the compound thing, where it's just the time under the bar, right? If you have more time under the bar than the other guy, you will very likely be in a completely different spot than they are. And it's just how it works when you put in that time consistently. And the consistency is the biggest thing. That's the hardest part. Like, it's really easy to go run out there and feel good one day and go bananas for 3 hours and feel really productive and then not pick up a bat for 2 weeks because you did your thing. And that's not going to be productive for you. You're not going to build habits. The habits come from the consistency. And that's the whole point of training, is to build habits so that you can go out there and compete in that game and not have to think about all these different mechanical things. You can just put your confidence and your trust in everything that you did leading up to that at bat.
Yeah. Makes sense.
So Brian, it's like, we've had so many different coaches, right? That come on with different philosophies. And I think this is another unique perspective,
right,
of how to approach the coaching side of it, how to get the kids to kind of, you know, show results and not just, like you said, Connor, not just, you know, let me go hit up my velo number, you know, this number, that number, is actually putting it all together so that this way, you know, all of it makes sense. And then the production level is just above and beyond that because, you know, you've given them the basis and kind of built them up to understand the game better. So I think your way of doing it is probably a unique way of way that I did not hear the way you explained it. I may do it that way, but to explain the reasoning behind it, you don't think about that. And that's a great way, the way you broke that down, is to really the quality of bats and kind of really, you know, expressing to the kids, you know, what it means to really have a, you know, to grow in the game and work in the game. And I think we try to teach them that the work ethic as well to kind of build on. And you're right, this generation is difficult for that because they have so many different distractions that take them away from the game, that to get them to say, if I tell them, hey, I need you to go home, I only have you 2 days a week, I need you to go home and do the same thing at home, there's too many distractions to get them focused. So, you know, as many ball players as we might have had years past, that number has dwindled a little bit. But I think what you guys are doing at MacStrength is really going to bring that back a little bit and get kids more excited and more into the game rather than just, you know, showing up to a park 2 days a week and then forgetting about it.
Right. Absolutely.
Well,
yeah, I totally agree with that. I think it was I picked up on a bunch of stuff that you got into here, and I think our listeners are gonna enjoy hearing that sort of your mindset about the game. And again, David, another great unique story and another person you've crossed paths with, David, that somehow David like runs into baseball people in the most random ways.
He somehow knows everybody too.
Yeah, I know. I know.
Yeah, and then it was like you're talking about like how these kids find all these distractions and they don't pick up a bat for like 2 days. It's like there's like lots of kids have video games and they're like, oh, I gotta play like Fortnite or whatever, and they just go to it and they're like, they haven't played baseball and they're like, why am I doing so bad and why am I always striking out? It's because like you haven't been practicing and just playing video games.
Just working out their fingers, right?
Yeah.
George, it's a good point, man. And I've talked with this about with my 13 you guys a little bit. It's just the first time you picked up your controller and played Fortnite, you were probably not good. And it's because you hadn't put in the time. You hadn't put in the time into Fortnite to be good. By the time that you've played Fortnite for 50 hours, you're probably better than you were when you played for 5 hours. And so it's the exact same thing for baseball. If you have only trained and only played baseball and only worked on hitting for 3 hours, you are not going to be as good as if you trained for 65 hours and then 1,000 hours, and then it just keeps going. Like that's how it works in baseball, video games, business, whatever you want it to be. That's what it takes.
That's a good point. That's a good point. Well, Connor, we appreciate you coming on today, sharing your story, giving us your insight on the game. We're wishing you, you know, the best of luck with this, with MacStrength Florida. I'm sure David will give me some insight. He'll probably be down there to check it out before too long. And if we get down to Southwest Florida, we'll stop in as well. We're about 3.5-4 hours away from you guys. But
we need a reason for you to get down here anyway. So here's your reason.
I know. I got. I mean, there's a million things. I think I'll have to come down there for a week with all the things that we can line up in that period of time. So
absolutely. Yeah, always welcome. George will have to get you some hacks in there.
Absolutely. Right?
Yep.
All right.
All right. So, I appreciate you guys having me.
You bet. Legends on Deck. Just gonna plug the merch shop here real quick. David.
Thank you, Easy Mortgage, once again for just sponsoring the show. 65 episodes. We're not cranking them out as much as we did last year, but it's still going strong. We got so many great stories that we've shared of people's journeys, and we're grateful for George there with his Damon glasses. But we're just grateful for all these great stories that we get to share. And like everyone knows, that Legends on Deck is a platform to kind of get out. It's not about me and Brian. It's about who are we interviewing, what stories are out there, great baseball stories, and what you guys are doing as a coach, as a trainer, for the next generation of ball players. You know, you're preparing them for life after baseball, life in baseball, whatever it is that they choose, you're giving them these great tools. So thank you again for being on the show and sharing that journey with us.
Thanks, guys.
Episode 65.
George with fancy glasses.